Hey everybody, this is Adam Kokesh here in the Freedomobile at Freedom Ranch inside today because it's a little bit nasty out. I wanted to get into what I think can only be described as the Trump-Johnson effect on libertarianism and the freedom movement in general. And it's really, really sad if you didn't notice this. I just got pointed out to me by my friend Anthony Antonello of Silence is Compliance, who just texted me. He went off grid for a while, you know, had to check out and take some time away from the crazy that has come to dominate the American news cycle, and said, "What is going on? It seems like all these people who I thought were libertarians have done a relapse. They've gone back to statism in the Trump era." And, you know, we've talked about this with Stefan Molyneux in the past and how disappointing it was that he was, I don't know, gave up what he described as his moral position and said, you know, like, let's go with the argument from effect. Let's become Donald Trump supporters. To the point where when Donald Trump won, he was singing the national anthem. I mean, this guy's supposed to be an anarchist and you're singing a national, you're singing the praises of government. Like, what? Is it something in the water in Canada? I don't know. Come on, Stefan. Like, really, this is nuts. But first I got to point out the setup for this, that, you know, with Gary Johnson as the LP nominee and Donald Trump as the GOP nominee, we had, as a movement, libertarians, we were faced with I don't think it was a difficult choice, but what for a lot of people was, because Donald Trump threw out a lot of red meat for libertarians. He said he was going to audit the Fed, right? He said that the Iraq War was a mistake. He said that, you know, he might reopen an investigation into 9/11. He said he was going to challenge the mainstream media, and that he did. And I got to say, of all the things about Donald Trump, that is one that I really do truly respect and appreciate, that he has challenged the mainstream media and continues to do so. That is huge. However, you know, like the old saying goes for sleazy politicians, when you see a riot, jump out in front of it and call it a parade, right? This was a trend that was already happening, that people were getting sick of the mainstream media lying, sick of the propaganda, sick of what was supposed to be their news outlets ending up as, you know, propaganda wings of the United States federal government. So, you know, in a sense, he's riding that wave. He's taking credit for it. Anybody who would have won in 2016, even if it was, except maybe Hillary Clinton, you know, would have been saying, yeah, hey, the mainstream media is full of crap. And we're, you know, of course, Donald Trump did that with an amazing flair. And I think that's great. But it's not like he's telling people to go and, you know, seek out alternative media sources or presenting some kind of different way of presenting information or anything like that. Now, I gotta make a comparison between Donald Trump and Barack Obama, because, like, when Donald Trump said all these things, I'm like, yeah, that's great! You know, the fact that he can even talk about 9/11, the fact that he's saying that the Iraq War was a mistake, that's huge, and it shows how far the American paradigm has shifted, how far people have come in their awareness in recent years. But remember, Barack Obama said he was going to end the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan, right? Now, what did he do? He had a surge in Afghanistan, and he kept troops in Iraq longer than they would have been there under President Bush's plan. You know, we thought he was going to end the war on drugs because he's President Choom. Oh, yeah, he's a pot smoker. He's the interceptor. He's all that. Yeah, no. If anything, federal enforcement of the drug war escalated under Barack Obama. There was a resistance even during that era to states legalizing marijuana at the state level. He said he was going to close Gitmo, you know, and of course, military spending went way up under Obama. The surveillance state exploded under Obama. All these basic trends of government growing over time continued under Obama. So, you know, it's kind of silly that, you know, we are falling for the same thing again, especially libertarians. You're supposed to be paying attention. You're supposed to have some historical perspective, you know? And they're all, Adam, Donald Trump is an outsider. He's the anti-establishment candidate. Well, that's what they said about Obama. But hey, you don't believe it? Okay, fine. Let's go back a little more. In the Republican Party, who was the last big anti-establishment candidate? The actor from California, Ronald Reagan, the Gipper, right? Turns out he was the least Reagan-esque of all presidents. He raised taxes. He passed gun control laws. He was divorced. He cut and run. He negotiated with terrorists. I mean, hello? Do you not see the pattern of being taken advantage of and disappointed by anybody who's in this political game, who's wanting to wield this power? I mean, it's ridiculous. So with Donald Trump, we see, like, even with the immigration thing, and of course, what's really sad is to see that, you know, so many libertarians who we like to think of ourselves as, you know, as intellectuals, or at least as, like, people who think for ourselves, people who aren't swayed by personality. Well, I'm going to support Trump, so I'm going to start rationalizing his positions. I'm going to start making excuses. And now all of a sudden, we have all these libertarians who are for closed borders. who are for government borders. It's like, hello, do you believe in government providing services or do you believe in the free market? It's really simple. The only legitimate borders are private property borders. So to see all these libertarians all of a sudden turning into huge statists who hate freedom of movement, who want to see freedom of movement curtailed, who make excuses like, well, we can't open the borders because we have a welfare state. Well, that's like saying, you know, hey, because I kicked your ass in a fight, you have to go beat up my little sister. Just doesn't follow. You know, that two wrongs don't make a right because the welfare state is wrong. Keeping people away from a certain geographic territory by force, it's not like that suddenly becomes not wrong. But I was, you know, this is happening like all across the movement, and it's really sad. And I have to wonder, you know, maybe just libertarians are humans too. You know, we're not as rational as we thought we were. And really, part of the temptation came from the juxtaposition of Donald Trump versus Gary Johnson, because Donald Trump promised, you know, all these little libertarian things. Well, not little, but big, you know, auditing the Fed, the Iraq War, 9/11, draining the swamp, right? As opposed to, like, hire everybody out of the depths of the swamp, which is what he's done. So enough libertarians went, well, I don't really like Gary Johnson because Gary Johnson, you know, wants me to, as a Jewish baker, to have to bake cakes for Nazis. You know, the Nazi cakes scandal that the brilliant Austin Peterson brought into the dialogue in the Libertarian Party in this nominating contest of 2016, asking Gary Johnson if he would force a Nazi, a Jewish baker, to bake cakes for a Nazi because it was, you know, would you bake a cake for a gay couple, the wedding cakes thing. And, you know, Gary Johnson is not a libertarian. Like, we've gone over this. He's a libertarian-leaning moderate. That's okay. You know, that is what it is. It doesn't win people over. It doesn't win elections. It doesn't even win votes, as we've seen in 2016. It's a losing strategy. If libertarians want to win, we got to win on principle. We have to understand those principles, and we have to stick to those principles. So Gary Johnson, with all of his anti-libertarian positions, forced a lot of libertarians to compare him to Trump, and it's like, well, Trump versus Johnson, and then they go, well, odds of winning, and, you know, Gary's not really running a vigorous campaign, and, you know, Bill Weld, you know, all the problems with his running mate being, you know, even more of a statist than Gary Johnson was, even though he called himself the original libertarian. We're just silly. And I got nothing against these guys. I think Gary Johnson is a great dude, man of integrity. He's a friend of mine. Bill Weld, you know, I don't really know him personally, but, like, I can't say I don't like him. He's a libertarian-leaning moderate, and that's fine. Not as good as being, like, an actual libertarian, because an actual libertarian is someone who embraces ethics as a guiding principle in their politics. You know, don't hit, don't steal, don't kill is not unless you work for the government. So, you know, all that said, it seems like because so many libertarians went towards Trump during the election, now they're like stuck on supporting him and rationalizing stuff that he's doing. And it's like, no, you still have to oppose the president. He's the president. He's the one in charge of this violent monopoly called the federal government. So it's really sad, you know. And Christopher Cantwell is another, you know, interesting example of this, of someone who, like, was shooting the American flag, actually shooting the American flag in videos, and now all of a sudden he's like, yeah, we need the government to control borders and keep people out and physical removal. And by the way, physical removal, the only right you have to physically remove anyone from anything is from your own property. You don't have a right to control any big territory and just put a border around it and say, well, we're going to remove people we don't like. And by the way, if you think we got to keep out immigrants because they might vote liberal, well, by that justification, it's self-defense, you got to kick out everybody in this country who voted liberal. Oh, which would include Donald Trump supporters, because when it comes down to it, this former Democrat Donald Trump is a liberal. He wants big government. He wants a big state. He wants a security monopoly. And now he's working. I mean, you see his proposed budget. He's going to be increasing military spending. Surprise, surprise, because that's where all the power really comes from the military-industrial complex and the ripoff that the security monopoly in that regard represents. So I was just talking to Gigi Bowman, just texting her about this, and it's like, it's really, really sad. Now, Gigi, I don't think was ever really a philosophical libertarian, ever got it at that, you know, level of ethics. But she's telling me that now Tom Woods, Justin Raimondo, Thomas Massie, and Lou Rockwell are also supporting Donald Trump. Like, what are you? Are we this easily fooled? You know, when it came to Trump versus Johnson, I told you, like, hey, between Johnson and, or between Trump and Clinton, it really doesn't matter. They're both big government statists. They are both going to carry on the growth of the state, and they're both going to perpetuate the status quo. Gary Johnson was the only one who would in any way really challenge that statist paradigm. Now, not completely, not as I would like, and all of that, but also, voting for Gary Johnson would have been building the Libertarian Party for the long run. And this is what's so sad about seeing these people who have fallen for the Trump-Johnson effect, is that they've had all this, they could be putting all of this effort that they're putting into supporting Trump, into winning converts, into converting Trump supporters and other statists into being libertarian, into thinking more about freedom as an ethical principle. And instead, they're defending the Muslim ban, they're defending all of his actions, they're like trying to find all these ways to say that Trump is a genius and a good guy. And you know what? I'm gonna go out on a limb here. You know, you guys can put in the comments, let me know what you think about where this is going, what you have to expect from Donald Trump. But I'm not hopeful. And, you know, I'll be happy. You know, you come talk to me in 4 years. Tell me if Trump's really radically changed things, if things have gotten radically better in Trump. And, you know, look, I don't doubt that he's going to be able to oversee a growth of the economy, because he might be able to tinker with some policies and be able to remove some restrictions. I think that's great. Not something he's going to really be able to take a whole lot of personal credit for, because it's something that anybody in the presidency was going to be having to do at this point anyway, or at least want to do when the opportunities present themselves to improve the economy, right? He might continue to challenge the mainstream media, but, you know, hey, in 4 years, if the Wall Street Journal and the New York Times and the Washington Post and MSNBC and NBC and ABC and everybody else, if they're all out of business and we have people doing independent media as the new mainstream, then, hey, I will eat crow. You know, if Donald Trump does any, if he reopens the investigation into 9/11 in an honest way and shows who was really behind it, hey, I will say, right on, good for you. You know, same thing with Obama. When Obama did good things, you say, hey, right on, good for you. But if your worldview is libertarian because you believe in ethics, you believe in principles, then you can't be a Donald Trump supporter. I mean, I support him living, I support him existing, I support him doing the good things he's doing, but like, politically as a whole, he's a violent statist who is overseeing the violent monopoly, who is not doing anything to significantly diminish the power of government, at least not right now. You know, like I said, I could be wrong. If he really does anything significant to shrink the power of the state, you know, hey, I'll apologize. I'll make a Donald Trump support video, but it's just really a lot like President Obama. You're going to be disappointed. And this whole Trump-Johnson effect thing, I don't know what to do about it, but I know that oftentimes we get a lot of fair-weather libertarians, people who want to call themselves libertarian when it's cool, when it's trendy, but when there's an opportunity to, hey, our guy's in power, we're the cool kids now, you know, they go for that. And there's a really sad kind of emotional fallibility that I'm seeing here. I mean, either that or it's a lack of intellectual philosophical grounding, but I don't think that's the case with Stefan Molyneux. You know, maybe for him selling out to Trump was a way to get views, and it's worked. I'd rather stick to principle and have a smaller audience than have a bigger audience based on deception or based on selling out my principles. I think there really is, you know, and if you look at Christopher Cantwell, who I debated recently, in Miami, it was a really great debate, and I consider all these people friends of mine, like Molyneux and Cantwell, I consider personal friends. Certainly Tom Woods. I don't really know Raimondo, Massey, or Mackwell that well personally, but like I like them, I appreciate them. I mean, even Rand Paul, you know, as a libertarian leaning conservative, I support him in the sense that I want him to do good work, but I'm not going to defend his worldview. I'm not going to support that, because when you really fully get libertarianism, you know, a lot of people come up to me and call me a hero, like people out of my own audience, you know, fans of mine, when I go out and tour, or, you know, people run into me when I'm doing man on the street videos or at the airport or whatever, out grocery shopping. Hey, Adam, you're a hero. And I have to say, hey, if you think I'm a hero, then you haven't really gotten the message yet, because this is about being your own hero. It's about leading yourself and embracing that fundamental right of an independent human will, being able to take charge of its own destiny. And when you really get it at that level, you don't fall for the petty emotional manipulations of statism. You don't fall for the cults of personality. You know, it's really about ideas and right and wrong rather than the individuals. So, like, this is why for me, you know, I killed Adam versus the Man. It's not Adam versus the Man anymore. It's just freedom! 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 It's not about me. It's about the message. And the people who get that aren't Trump supporters. Because the emotional appeal, the appeal to personality, the appeal of belonging, you know, you want to be part of the in crowd, you want to be one of the cool kids, is only possible with people who are psychologically deficient in this way. And yes, I'll say that about, you know, either all these people involved that I'm mentioning are in some way, if they're really falling for this, or they're just taking advantage of the people who are. You know, like, if you really think that some politician is going to make you free as opposed to you freeing yourself in your own mind, then you don't get this. Then you don't really get the implications of the message of freedom. Maybe you understand the politics or the positions and how it applies and the logic of self-ownership and the non-aggression principle. But there's something missing from your psychological makeup. There's something missing in your life that I encourage you to reclaim. I encourage you to embrace truly, fully self-ownership, to really take charge of your own life, to defeat this Trump-Johnson effect by rejecting all cults of personality and saying, no, I'm going to think for myself, I'm going to be a free individual. But hey, if you want to be a cult part of my cult of personality, don't forget to subscribe to this channel, don't forget to like this video, and I hope you'll share it, and you know, maybe we can rebuild the freedom movement. Maybe we don't have to. Maybe we've got, you know, the real core adherents identified now, and we can go about actually waking people up who are ready to hear this message, you know, already have that psychological component and are just missing the political component. Because obviously that's a lot more important. After my debate with Christopher Cantwell, someone pointed out to me that it's not so much about freedom versus tyranny as it is love versus hate. Because there are people who kind of understand freedom but are still haters fundamentally. And hate comes from insecurity. If we are able to embrace that sense of self and taking charge of your own life, then you're not a hater anymore. You know, you get to be just a lover. And I think it's easier to make someone who's a lover, who's maybe an idiot, but a happy, secure, well-adjusted person, it's easier to get them to commit to the ideals of libertarianism, you know, as principles, than it is someone who's a hater, who's really smart, who's going to say, okay, well, I get it, but screw this. I want to make the argument from effect of immediate consequence, of the consequentialist argument, and I want something that's going to pay me off. So I'm going to go work for government. I'm going to go join the bureaucracy. I'm going to go work for the dark side. And that's scary. So stick to principles. Defeat the Trump-Johnson effect. Mwah. Peace and love.